let's start off by looking at the traditional attack surface. This is where most of the hacks happen today. Maybe more updated hardware, but still there. And we have a poor track record, but we're quite good at protecting this. We know what to do. We know that we need a firewall, and we know that we need an antivirus and all that. And we can protect single devices, and we can protect them when they're networked together. However, with IoT, this kind of changes. Now, this is David's favorite IoT device, or one of them at least. And this is the new attack surface. Ordinary household items become interested for hackers as targets. And this particular one here is called the eye kettle. And I won't get any sponsor money from this now. And this is an ordinary water kettle. It boils water. It's good at it. You can also, if you ask it nicely, you can get the password for the Wi-Fi it is connected to. And you do this quite easily through something that was intended to be used for maintenance. And this really encapsulates the problem with connected devices. And further to emphasize this, I'd like to talk about something this man said. This here is James Clapper, and he's the director of natural intelligence in the United States. And what they do is basically train and manage spies. And quite recently, he admitted that they are considering, and potentially even already doing it, to use internet-connected devices, which already exists, for identification, surveillance, monitoring, location tracking, among other things. And if Mr. Clapper here, he can be considered a good guy, depending on what your point of view is. But if now intelligence agents are considering doing this and doing it, then other types of organizations and even individuals can do this and will do it. So this makes it very important to treat this data that we're collecting or the devices that we have connected in a secure and proper way. And as an example of a wrong way of collecting data, there is a company called Samsung. You might have heard of it. It's fairly large. They create or manufacture a lot of TVs. And last year, they went out and warned their own customers not to disclose any private information in front of their TV. Where else would you disclose private information? So the reason for that is because smart TVs that they manufacture are always on. You might switch it off, but it's still on. And it's monitoring its surroundings. And why is it doing that? Because it's waiting for voice commands. So it's recording voices, sends them off to an external server for processing, and sometimes those servers are from third parties. So it might be good for controlling your TV, but because of this, Samsung can't guarantee that your private conversations in your own home remain confidential. There's something wrong with that picture, but this is the core of the problem. And of course, it's not only about boiling water or arguing about remote control in front of the TV, because we are connecting more and more things in our surroundings. So for example, we have the smart car. And they measure practically anything thinkable about your driving skills. And imagine if your insurance company knew that you're setting a new record every day between your workplace and home. It wouldn't be particularly good for your insurance costs. And of course, we are automating our homes. We're connecting everything from light bulbs to washing machines and water kettles. And do we really want this type of information to be traded alongside with our identities on the markets of the dark net? So we need to protect that. And then, of course, we have our kids. We want to know that they're safe. We want to know that they're in school or they have arrived at home on time and safely. But we're equally comfortable with having their exact GPS position being publicly available on a search engine. Probably not. So we need to protect that. And of course, is our hopefully not so frequent visits to the hospital, together with all the medical values, something we want to be part of the credit rating of our next loan application? Probably not, so we need to protect that. And this is really bigger than just the us as individuals, because we are starting to connect cities. And will come soon, and it's already happening. And once we do that, we have a responsibility as working within the field of IoT to protect every single person that we're measuring. So that data cannot be used for any wrongful reasons. And there are a few areas that we need to consider when we're dealing with this type of real-time data we're collecting for everywhere. And I have chosen just a few topics to keep it short. There are many more, and they might be equally important. But I've chosen these, and the first one here is privacy. And this is quite obvious. I mean, we want privacy. And usually, traditionally, this has been solved with encryption. And it's probably the best way of doing it as well. So we need to make sure that we, at the moment we collect it from a device somewhere, and during the whole transmission, and when we analyze it, until we're done with it and put it in some sort of cold storage somewhere else, we need to make sure it remains confidential. And this is obvious. I mean, we all know that we need to create secure communication channels. That's basic knowledge. But did we remember that in each and every step up to the cold storage? Do we know who has access to the cold storage? Do we know where it is? Do we know how it looks like? If it's encrypted? And you'd be surprised how many times we don't know that. So this is an area which is becoming even more important, not just when we're transmitting it, but when we store it, when we're not going to use it anymore. Secondly, we have integrity. And this is about, do we know if this data that we have collected, that it's still intact? Has anyone modified it? Do we know that we can trust that data? Do we know that that device that produced that data has been compromised? And if it has been compromised, it might be they're feeding in false data into our systems. How do we detect that? Well, of course, again, encryption plays an important part. But not only encryption, we need to use more things here. We need to be able to identify each and every device that is producing data for us. We need to have them to authenticate towards our system in one way or another. And of course, we need to use blacklist or even whitelist to control which device is allowed to give us data and not give us data. And of course, we can use analytics here. We can take this data and we can look at it and we can see and try to identify patterns that are a bit out of the ordinary. But that won't work from day one, because patterns is something you can do when you have something to compare it to. So you always need a baseline first. It takes quite some time until you can use analysis to find suspicious activities. Although with a city connected, it probably doesn't take that too long time, because you get collect an enormous amount of data. But one crucial step here as well is manual audit. Because we can do a lot of things automatically using techniques and things that we implement, but we still need to look at this from some sort of admin perspective. We need to go in and look for that suspicious behavior. We need to make sure that everything is working as it should. So it's not just about collecting data and doing it. There's a lot of work to make sure it doesn't fall in the wrong hands, or that we received data that has been fabricated in any way. The last one I'll mention is anonymity. Not sure why I would choose that picture, but still. And this is because once we start connected everything, we're not just getting measurements or data from anonymous sources. We're getting data that can be directly linked to individuals. And sometimes they're not directly linked, but they can be linked by using another set of data to individuals. So we have multiple problems when it comes to anonymity. We might collect data without any sort of individual data behind it, but another company or another system we're doing is collecting some data. And when you put those two together, all of a sudden you know who the person that produced the data are. And this is very difficult. It's very difficult to produce anonymous data. And again, it sounds like I repeat myself, encryption is part of this. But we also need things like access control. Who and why and when is looking at this data? And who cannot look at this data? And who cannot look at this data set but this data set? It's very important. But there are also other ways of separating data that points to a person and the collected data for measurements. We can store that in different places. And there are also advanced algorithms and search queries that you can use, which kind of separates the data storage from on the database to what the query will produce, and stripping away all the personal information. The medical industry has been doing this for many, many years. They have very tight and strong regulations about how to store data when it comes to things that could be linked to individuals. And of course, we have laws that govern this as well. The problem with this new field of IoT is that most of us that works with it, we're not coming from that sector. We're coming from other industries. We have never worked with this type of data before. We don't know about this problem, and we might not consider it. But out of these three, is probably, from an individual perspective, the most important part. It does cost a lot of money, though, because it requires more servers, more databases, more processing time, and of course, more implementation time. So if you consider a normal project, what's the first thing that gets cut? Might be security, might be that additional database. But we shouldn't, because this is the most important one. Not because the man behind this face might access it, but just because we cannot store data that links back to individuals. So what happens when an area like IoT is created? And why do we always put security in as an afterthought? And it really comes down to how we are as humans. Because we are driven by the factor of innovation. We like to make our lives better, easier. We want to have more time to do leisure activities. And as engineers, we want to work within the cutting edge field. We want to make that next fantastic product. We want to take that new field of that new technology and do something incredible with it. We don't want to secure it. That gives us restrictions. So security isn't the driving force here. Making life better or doing something incredible is. This is why we put security as individuals on a lower priority. And then, of course, there are commercial interests that might also prevent us from doing proper security. There might be cost, or there might be interest in collecting data in a particular way. And we do have a responsibility there. So there are another side to this, and that's governments. Governments usually wake up a few years later and realize we have a new technology. And, oh, we need to maybe control this technology. And the way they do that is that they create laws, which take time. So they usually come many, many years after we actually have finished products that we're using, and can affect a market quite heavily. Because the problem with laws is that they're quite blunt. They're not very precise, and they hit like a hammer. But still, it's the best way we have to regulate the markets. But we have sort of a middle ground here, and we're seeing this happening right now, and that's standardization. The big players, and even the small players in IoT, is now coming together, and they're trying to find standards in this. And one standard they're working on is security. But the big problem with standardization and certification processes and all that is that it takes forever. And sometimes they never finish. They have like a beta version of their standard for like 10 years. Because there are so many companies involved, and IoT is a so big area with so many players. Everyone wants to put their opinions in. Everyone has their own agenda. So that's going to take a long time. So in the meantime, we have a responsibility to make sure that we implement this in the best possible way from all perspectives, not just security perspective, although that's a very important one. I think I'm quite well on time. This is the last slide I have. And I'm just going to touch on a current event, which is going to change end user security in general, as we know it, but it's also going to affect IoT. And this very poor quality image is taken from an advertisement in 1984 that Apple produced. It has its obvious sort of inspirations, mainly because of the year, I guess. But in this one, IBM was the evil force. But now Apple is fighting the FBI. And what FBI wants Apple to do is they want access to an encrypted device, an iPhone. And that iPhone was used in a criminal activity, a terrorist act, actually. And Apple is refusing to comply with that. And it sounds quite bad. Why wouldn't we help, or in this case, Apple help to sort of, in this terrorist act, help out and make sure that they get all the facts and they can conduct their investigation. But Microsoft and Google and Facebook and many other companies is backing Apple on this. And why are they doing that? Because they know that if FBI gets their way and makes Apple to decrypt or put in a backdoor into the iPhone, even if it's in a laboratory sort of setting, it will change the right for the privacy of every one of us. Because all of a sudden, we have said it's okay to decrypt or put backdoors into this private data for everyone, and we can't protect individuals anymore. We can't protect the messages that we send between our loved ones, and we can't protect our credit rating from our medical history. We can't do anything anymore because we have let that box, we have opened that box, and there's really no way back. So this court case that is currently playing out in America is going to be a landmark for how encryption and privacy and confidential information is going to be treated and what governments can do. And when governments can get your private data, basically everyone else can do as well. Because a backdoor is not going to not let anyone who isn't a government official in, it's going to let anyone who knows about it in. So this is very important. This is an example where a government is trying to change your market in a negative way. But that doesn't mean that if we had an unregulated market, it would be better, because it will have problems on its own. I'm not going to go into details on that. So if you're interested, we could talk about that afterwards. But we need that balance. And the balance isn't the driving force with this or the government. It is that standardization. But while waiting for that, it's all of us who works with IoT that needs to take the responsibility and make sure that we treat everyone's private data. We put up sensors, we put up lots of connected devices, and for the individual that we're actually monitoring, for them to feel secure in this environment, we also need to treat their data with respect and confidentiality.